Good evening. This is a regular meeting of the School Board of Kenosha Unified District Number 1. Notice of the regular meeting was given to the public by forwarding the complete agenda to all requesting radio stations and the newspapers. Copies of the complete agenda are available for inspection at all public schools and at the superintendent's office. Anyone desiring information as to forthcoming meetings should contact the superintendent's office. At this time, we'll ask you to please stand and join me in stating the Pledge of Allegiance. Thank you. Roll call, members, please.
Ms. Stevens?
Yes.
Mrs. Snyder?
Yes.
Mr. Koenig?
Here.
Mr. Garcia?
Yes.
Mr. Falkowski?
Yes.
Mr. Wade?
Yes.
Mrs. Coleman?
Present. Thank you. At this time, we'll move to awards and recognitions. Dr. Sue Savaglio-Jarvis?
I believe we have none this evening. Oh, sorry, Tanya, we do? Oh, no, we have none. Okay, thank you.
All right, summertime fun.
Do you have a legislative report tonight? No.
Pardon?
No legislative report?
Are you kidding?
Okay.
Administrative and supervisory appointments, Dr. Sue Savaglio-Jarvis?
That I know, we have none this evening. Thank you.
At this time, do we have a legislative report? Or are we going to table until August when they're back in session? Okay, excellent. At this time, we'll have views and comments from our public, and welcome to all those who have signed up to speak tonight to the board. We would like to remind you that school board meetings are not public meetings, but official business meetings held in public. Board meetings are conducted for the purpose of carrying on the business of the district. Even so, the board has established this opportunity to hear public input on district issues through guidelines set out in school board policy and rule 8870 titled Public Participation at School Board Meetings. This policy allows citizens an opportunity to make comments during the views and comments portion of the regular school board meeting. Speakers are limited to 3 minutes, and comments may deal with any topic related to the district issues or concerns and or the board's agenda. However, in public session, the board shall not hear irrelevant, repetitive, abusive, or harassing speech, or speech that causes disruption to the orderly conduct of the meeting. The board shall also not hear discussion of confidential personnel disputes or grievances involving individual school employees that do not implicate issues of public concern or individual student disciplinary matters, as there are other channels available in the district that provide for consideration and disposition of such matters. Although we may not respond to every comment tonight and may only deal with published agenda items as stated in Wisconsin Open Meeting Law, your concern will be recorded and forwarded to the appropriate staff. As you approach the microphone, please state your name and address. Again, welcome to tonight's speakers, and this portion will conclude after 45 minutes. Our secretary will be taking the time. We'll start with Gail Clark Taylor, followed by Kyle Flood.
Hello, Gail Clark Taylor, 7624 18th Avenue, Kenosha. I'm here tonight to speak about your transgender policy, for lack of better terms. And I understand it's not on your agenda tonight, but I would like to have my say about this. When I reviewed the published notes of the last policy meeting, one part of this that particularly grabbed me was the part where you said, the district shall modify a student's official record to reflect a change in a student's legal name and or gender, sex upon receipt of a court order requiring such a modification. I have a big problem with that. Students of high school age or younger are not going to have the opportunity to go through a legal proceeding to have their gender legally changed. We have to rely on their parents to do that for them. And as you, if you read my email that I sent out to you earlier this afternoon, President Obama, in his letter of May 13th, recommended that parents would have the appropriate responsibility to notify the school administration that a student will assert for themselves a gender different from their birth certificate. and at this time, they would be treated as any other boy or any other girl, whether if someone's identifying as female, they will be treated as a female. If they identify as male, they will be treated as a male. If those, if that's not appropriate for them, then they should be going to administration or someone else that can make a choice about these kind of things and work together to protect the student. One of the things that I found very interesting in Mr. Obama's statement was that to, I'm going to back up a little bit and try to read some paraphrasing here. If someone is treated consistent with their gender identity, and this may violate Title 19, when doing so has practical effect of limiting or denying students equal access to an education or program or activity. So we are obligated to let them identify as the gender of their choice and access all the educational activities that would be awarded to a person of that gender of their choosing. No one goes through this just spur of the moment. I'm no longer a girl, I want to be a boy. It's a long, long process, and we need to trust parents and their children that they can make their choice for themselves. Another aspect of Mr. Obama's letter, which I do not have in front of my face, but it was basically to the extent of making a decision simply to protect the uncomfortable feelings of everyone
else.
I'm
sorry, but your time is up.
Is not protecting the student in question.
Thank you, Ms. Gail Clark Taylor. Mr. Flood?
Hi, Kyle Flood, 5302 35th Avenue. I was here to speak on one topic, but I thought I'd mention one other thing. I saw that Dr. Sue's contract is up for renewal today, and I know that when I was on the board, I was the one board member that voted against it because of a lot of uncertainty. But tonight, I do want to express that I am, would be thrilled to see Dr. Sue's contract extended. I think she's doing a wonderful job. I think she's doing the best job that she could do. And so it would be very nice to see that tonight. I hope that every board member plans on voting that way. I also wanted to speak a little bit on the annual meeting. The annual meeting is something that occurs every year where the electors can actually come and vote on subjects like electing a chairperson for the meeting, the school board salary, and approving the tax levy. This year, I've petitioned the board to include a special subject. I turned in 108 signatures, exceeding the minimum requirement by 8. To request that the lawsuit and legal proceedings concerning the Ash Whitaker's lawsuit be put on the agenda so that the voters may direct the board on how to proceed on this. A couple things about this whole Ash quality issue. I've seen a lot of privacy advocates who want a government body like the school district or anyone to seem to intrude on an individual's personal knowledge of their gender identity. I don't know how that's protecting privacy. I don't get that. That's none of their business. That's no one's business but the individual whose gender identity that belongs to. That's not privacy. And the only thing that would drive that I can understand would be bigotry. And bigotry is the first step towards that nanny state. It's the first step towards a wristband. It's the first step towards a tattooed serial number, and it's wrong. The board has proven its inability to address this issue. We've been sued, we've had negative national news attention, and our school funding has been put at risk. The transgender issue can't be in your hands. It needs to be in the hands of the people. When I left elected office and lost my election for city council, I took on the title Kenosha Advocate, because now my intention is to advocate for Kenosha, to make sure that Kenosha is on the right side of history of issues, to make sure that Kenosha's image is good. That's not what's happening with how this issue has been handled. Kenosha looks stupid. I understand now that this is in the hands of Mr. Wade, the board clerk. Mr. Wade, I speak directly to you. We're within our legal rights here. It says legal proceedings very clearly. I've cited the law several times. Please follow the law. Please put this item on the agenda. This can no longer be up to you. This must be up to the people of Kenosha. Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Flood. At this time, we'll move to response and comments by the board. And go ahead and use your lights at this time. Okay. Mr. Koenig.
Thank you. You know, as we've said since the beginning on this transgender issue, you know, this is something we're weighing very seriously. I think, you know, I speak for a lot of people when I say I'm a little frustrated that it's not here yet, and that I get it that we're taking our time, and that's important. But we want it done just as much as anyone else. I'm also frustrated that because, you know, we're constrained because of lawsuits and such that what we can say and can't say. But I will reiterate what I told the Kenosha News, and I'm going to say it again today, and something that I think is highly inappropriate that you said, Mr. Flood, making insinuations or accusations or inaccurate, sensationalized comparisons to Nazism with these green wristbands. The green wristbands is a flat-out lie, never existed, and, you know, and I cited Inquisitor.com, and to insinuate that it did exist or that this administration tried to do something like that is flat-out wrong and inappropriate and inexcusable. It never happened. I am looking forward to this lawsuit going forward, and I do believe the administration is going to be victorious in this lawsuit because everything that I've looked at, this administration has gone out of its way to be accessible and accepting of all students, regardless. When issues arose as far as the prom issue, they addressed that issue. But consistently, this administration has done everything it can do for all students. The decision we make here on this school board is eventually going to be something that is made for all students. Is it going to make everybody happy? No. Someone's going to be happy and someone's going to be unhappy. But, and I don't know what it's going to be, you know, because we'll see that. But whatever it is, just because somebody does get their way or doesn't get their way does not mean someone was discriminated against. It does not mean there was bigotry. It means a decision was made for all students. I have not seen in any way, shape, or form, in any way, anyone on this school board, and I'm speaking for all seven of us, please correct me if I'm wrong, I've not seen anyone on this school board or anyone in this administration in private one-on-one meetings or agenda reviews say anything along the line that we are intruding or stopping anyone from being who they are or who they want to be. We're not intruding on any sexual identity in any way, shape, or form. We're not demanding that someone be a sexual identity. It's never come up. I've never seen it. No student, no teacher, no counselor, no principal, no administrator has come to me and said that has happened. No, I cannot fathom anyone on this board, regardless of where we stand, would ever stand for a policy that says we're going to intrude on somebody's right to be the sexual identity that they believe themselves to be. I think, you know, one of the great things about the fact that we live in America is the fact that you are free to be whoever you are and whoever you want to be. And there are some countries where people, if they were gay or transgender, they would be imprisoned and they would be stoned to death, okay? That's not happening here. Okay? Nobody's being imprisoned. Nobody's being stoned to death. Nobody is being denied any educational privileges based on their sexual identity. I'm just getting a little heated because I am so angry at this entire green wristband thing that did not exist, and I went over what I was going to say. Thank you.
You did. I was going to cut you off. Sorry, Mr. Koenig. Mrs. Stevens.
I'd like to thank the speakers for coming and speaking tonight. I think that the policy that we are working on has needs improvement, and I think that when we're done with that, you will see a policy that supports all students. That's our goal. As a school board, it always has been, so I'm hopeful that through the change and policies that we propose to improve, because I had concerns. I was at the committee meeting, and I read through it, and I had some concerns as well. So I think that we're going to come up with a good policy, and it will support all students. So I'm hoping that your petition won't be necessary, Kyle, and that we'll get this all settled moving forward in a positive direction. and I appreciate you coming and speaking, both of you, to this, because I have concerns as well. So thank you.
Mr. Fikowski?
I'm going to speak to Gary's comments, but I'm going to speak to the board at large about this. I think we need to be very careful on what we say happened or didn't happen. To the best of our knowledge, he was not required to wear a green band, but we do not know what kind of discussions. And until that is heard in a court of law, we should not be making those kind of judgments. I feel very uncomfortable. I'm open to all ideas or all suggestions of what could have happened, but we need to hear that court case in front of a judge, in front of lawyers, or wherever it goes. I also saw you put that on social media. That's why I just wanted to express, I think as board members, you got to be very, very careful, because we could step into a minefield and get ourselves sued in the process. And I just want to agree with what Mrs. Stevens said. I was on the policy committee, and I did vote to forward it to the board, but I had reservations, but I wanted to bring it to the board because I wanted this all to discuss it. Now, I understand that we're reviewing it again, and the administration, Dr. Sue's going to take a look at it and bring it back. So I look forward to seeing the changes, and hopefully we'll have a policy that, as Rebecca said, or Ms. Stevens said, we won't require Kyle's petition at the end. I mean, I'd like to have the board take the responsibility, and specifically, well, we can't, yeah, sorry. I'm going to stop right there, and I'm going to stop before I break any open meetings law.
Thank you, Mr. Fikowski. And I'll just say to the two of you, thank you for coming to speak to us tonight. I know it's always difficult to come before the board and share your own personal concerns and comments. So thank you for coming forward. And yes, I did pull the agenda, that item from the agenda. I sat through committee meetings, and after speaking with Dr. Sue, we both felt that we needed to look at some things. So I'm glad we're doing that, and we will do that, and we will have a solid policy that all students, we're supporting all students, and that all students will feel safe in this learning environment that they're in. So thank you. Anyone else? Okay, nobody else? Okay, good. So we'll move to the president's remarks. I just have a few tonight. Although the summer is flying by, the learning opportunities have surely not stopped. The first summer school session has come and gone, and the second session will be ending in just a few short days. I'm humbled at all the learning opportunities that we had for our students during the summer recess, and I know that the students and families are enjoying themselves. I had the opportunity to stop by Bowles Summer School Inquiry Fair, where students from Bowles, Harvey, and Summers showcased their projects about animals, plants, and the environment. Brass and Roosevelt students proudly presented their projects at their annual fair as well, and topics covered an array of natural disasters and landform projects. These are just a few of the many showcases of the summer learning opportunities that we've had going on at all of our schools. Not only are our students learning, but I applaud all of our hardworking staff who have been taking courses and professional development training classes. All of our staff are working hard in and out of their classroom and or building, preparing for our students who will be filling the halls and classrooms in less than 45 days. Very hard to believe. I can't thank you all enough for your hard work and dedication. And I want to applaud our leadership council because they're working very hard and diligently with all summer, making sure that our classrooms are ready and our teachers are ready and all ready to go. So thank you. I also had the honor of attending the KUSD Summer Student Art Show at the Civil War Museum. It ran from July 11th through the 17th. The amazing talent of our students left me once again speechless. I was honored to vote on behalf of the board on our one art piece that I do believe you all will be very pleased, I hope you're pleased, at the chosen selection. I did share with Dr. Sue that we will need to talk to Mr. Plank because picking one is just too difficult. So we'll have to see how we can pick more than one. I'd also like to congratulate Washington Middle School on receiving the 2016 Fitness Center and Equipment of $100,000. What an amazing honor, and I can't wait to see all the amazing equipment that our students and staff will be able to enjoy this upcoming school year. Maybe the board can go in there and do some working out ourselves. We'll see. They're all laughing. Yes, and Dr. Sue can guide us. Parents, registration is open for the upcoming school year. I just wanted to send a little reminder. Please be sure you're registering your students. You can either go to your individual school child's school's website or KUSD.edu to log in and register. And finally, just want to make a quick announcement that the Board of Education is currently accepting applications for our four standing committees: personnel and policy, curriculum, Audit, Budget, Finance, as well as Facilities. These committees meet once a month for approximately 1 hour, and it's on the second Tuesday of every month. The committee is made up of board members and our wonderful individuals right from our community. The deadline to apply has been extended to August 5th. We're getting a lot of applicants, and so we want to make sure that we can maximize the number of people that are interested. And if you are interested still, please submit a letter of interest to our board secretary, Stacy, at sbusby@kusd.edu, or you can drop off a letter of interest right here at the ESC building to her attention. Please continue to enjoy your summer, and we look forward to kicking off a school year very soon. This concludes my remarks. I'll now turn it over to Dr. Sue Sebaglio-Jarvis for her remarks. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam President, members of the board. Just two things that aren't on my superintendent report. Just want to wave to my dad out there, pleasant surprise. So, hi, Dad. I think he comes out when mom leaves, so maybe many of you men understand that when the woman's out, you get to get out. So thank you, Dad, for being here. It's a pleasure. It's surprising. And I did, with Washington Middle School, I did challenge Mr. Tolfrey to a liftoff. So we'll see if he... Oh, they're over there. I'm not so sure he's going to take that challenge, but we shall see. Yeah, we could do that. So we'll see. He does. He knows that, but he's a little bit shy right now, I think. Anyway, back to the script. Tonight, I want to share a few items from this summer that showcase, and Ms. Coleman, you have mentioned many of them. No, that's fine. I know we double team here. But one of the biggest pieces that anyone actually can see as they travel throughout our community truly is the athletic project that is taking shape, getting closer to finalization each day. Bradford Stadium is truly looking like field ready to really host some of our amazing events this school year. The bleachers are in, and work to complete them is well underway. The final preparation for the synthetic turf is being performed this week, and the light poles, I mean, thank heavens the weather has been truly wonderful, so the construction continues. If you haven't driven past also at Bullen, the asphalt for the new tennis courts was completed last week. The surfacing will be done in a few weeks. At Tremper, finally, those home side bleachers are still being installed, but they hope to have in place and completed for games that are really quickly approaching. It truly is amazing, as you had shared, the wonderful and how many people in this community are working diligently to complete these large projects for our students and our community. So thank you to everybody. Summer preparation, kind of interesting for fall sports, is well underway. High school students are really in the gym right now, weight rooms, practice fields. In fact, next week, as you mentioned, it's coming down to the wire here with summer. And the weeks after, we begin football, girls golf, girls tennis, girls swimming, girls diving, boys soccer, volleyball, and cross country. So all this excitement continues to mount as we start getting ready for our new school year. In addition to the visual athletic projects, we have had more than 5,000 students participating in elementary, middle, and high school summer learning opportunities. That has grown over the last several years. So again, kudos to our many staff that have just really expanded these summer opportunity programs, and to Julie Hausman and the Teaching and Learning Department for ensuring that our children have an opportunity to extend their learning. Mahone Middle School students did a project-based learning approach with an emphasis on water, which included boat races and videos about the need to conserve water. Lincoln Middle School hosted a project-based learning open house for students to showcase their work to their families. Bowes Elementary and Brass hosted an inquiry fair for students and families to view final projects for their weeks of learning. So you can see there's a lot of not only student learning, but family learning now engagement. Really cool. I wish I had this when I was here. As an elementary or middle school student who participated in the forensic science camp at Bradford, they tried to solve a case of who ate the principal's sandwich, investigating a crime scene and using DNA testing, fingerprinting, and other cool investigation tools. I know. Doesn't that sound like fun? All right, who ate my lunch? I think we should... Nobody wants my lunch.
They're all like, what?
Okay, all right, just wait till I order that pizza. It'll be vegetarian. 140 students are participating in Black Watch, that marching band that we have. 125 participate in the middle school band. Very exciting. This week we open with Kai Pak. So excited, Peter Pan Jr. There's actually 117 students, which opens Thursday, 7 o'clock. So Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, four shows. That was going to draw a huge crowd from our community and parents. Numerous teachers spent time working on curriculum development in the areas of English, fine arts, science, social studies, and world language in preparation for the school year. The Office of Professional Learning offered over 30 courses and workshops for district staff this summer, in which 408 staff members took part. Topics included mathematically, like numbers talk, support English language learners in reading, word study, writer's workshop, nonviolent crisis intervention, and others on Google. I mean, any time of the day you come through this building, it is just happening. It just happened this summer. And last but not least, we have really exciting things happening in our career and tech education realm. As you know, you just approved Cheryl Coley to that position. Just this summer, we purchased 4 new 3D printers, and 5 staff are going to 3D printer certification training for free, thanks to a $5,000 sponsorship from Gateway Technical College. And it's believed that these 3D printers will become a household norm, and there are facilities learning for that 21st century learner. Really, to help you envision what this means, we'd like to just show a commercial from Dremel. And the interesting piece, the commercial is our students are showcased. So these are our own students in a commercial for Dremel. Lots of things.
The best technology-based tools in the 21st century classroom are the highly interactive ones. Digital whiteboards, computers, and tablets all allow students to explore, create, and develop the problem-solving skills they'll need in a world growing more dependent on STEM-based technologies. The Dremel 3D Idea Builder takes that learning to a whole new level. Start designing from scratch using a program like Autodesk's Tinkercad, or download any 3D print-ready models from Dremel3D.com. Using Dremel's intuitive, easy-to-use print preparation software, you can move, rotate, and scale models before printing to maximize the quality of your project. Students become completely engaged when they integrate design thinking skills into their creations. 3D printing teaches students through problem-based learning and experimentation, encouraging them to refine their designs in an ongoing process where they can see the tangible results of their critical thinking. Incorporating 3D printing into your classroom is easy with the Dremel Dreams program, a collection of comprehensive 3D-specific lesson plans written by actual teachers and subject matter experts. The Dremel 3D Idea Builder includes the print-ready model files, so you can start integrating 3D printing into your classroom right out of the box. Students engage and retain subject matter more when they connect a real hands-on experience with an abstract concept. They build valuable and relevant skills for tomorrow's world, and a successful understanding can help shape a student's future career. The Dremel 3D Idea Builder. Give your students the power to build their imaginations.
So very exciting things happening, and looking forward to a great start to a new year. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sue Savaglio-Jarvis. It's awesome. At this time, we'll move to the business portion, our consent agenda. I'll entertain a motion.
I'd like to make a motion to accept administration's recommendation of the consent agenda.
Second.
It's been properly moved and second. All in favor, please state any discussion. I'm sorry. All in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it. Motion carries. I can't believe it, but at this time, we have no old business. So we'll move right into our new business portion. We'll have discussion action on hearing officers. Dr. Sue Savaglio-Jarvis.
Thank you, Madam President, members of the board. Annually, the administration brings forth recommendation concerning appointments for our hearing officers. This year, what we did was we updated the job description as well, and the job was posted just to see if there are any new candidates out there and an opportunity for people to apply. Unfortunately, no new applicants met the minimum requirements for this position. So at this point, in the middle of your report there, you'll see the two members that we're recommending to continue. So again, administration recommends that the Board of Education authorize the appointment of the two recommended hearing officers for the purpose of expulsion hearings during the 2016-2017 school year. The rate has been set at $100 per hearing, and that rate has remained the same for the last several years. That has not changed. So,
correct.
I'd like to make a motion to accept administration's recommendation regarding the hearing officers.
It's been properly moved and second. And I, any discussion? And I just want to make one comment. I want to thank Dr. Sue, you and your team for putting this out to an RFP, because I had asked last year that we make sure that we do that this year, because you just never, it had been a couple years since we had done anything. So thank you for doing that. We didn't get anybody, so we do what we need to do. So thank you for that. Any other discussion? We have a motion on the floor. All in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it, motion carries. We'll now move to discussion action, renewal of the Southeastern Wisconsin School Alliance membership. Dr. Sue Savaglio-Jarvis.
Thank you, Madam President. Members of the board, again, this is another annual. Basically, for the past 13 years, have invested in our SWSA partnership with them, and they do provide, as outlined, numerous articles and reviews and information. They're very helpful. So we are recommending we continue with them, attach the resolution and membership for SWSA for this 2016-17 school year.
Motion to accept.
I'll second that.
It's been probably moved and second. Any discussion? Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it. Motion carries. We'll now move to discussion action. Miscellaneous employee reclassification, health insurance premium contribution rates, and I just want to kind of be specific, 2017-18. Mm-hmm. Okay. Dr. Savaglio-Jarvis.
Correct. Thank you, Madam President, members of board. I mean, this has been an ongoing process for the school district to really take a look at our classification of our employees. As you know, we've had a group identified as miscellaneous employees for a period of time. And over the course of time, we've had a compensation study that was done and provided some recommendations. So at this time, I'll turn it over to Annie just to give a little background and then obviously provide an opportunity for you to ask questions. But we are just basically really recommending at the end here that you approve these newly assigned contribution rates noted in Attachment A of your report for the reclassified miscellaneous employees. Again, they won't have that title anymore of miscellaneous. They will feel a sense of belonging. But we're asking that you approve those rates. So, Annie, if you want to go through the report a little bit?
Sure. Thank you.
So, Annie, I'm sorry. I'm just going to stop before. I'm sorry. One second.
Okay?
Yes, we got updated. This was updated, if my memory serves me correctly.
Correct.
And we should have an update. Okay. Thank you, Stacey. I knew we got an email that this was updated. So for those, I asked for a hard copy.
And I think the only update was there was a typo.
Yeah, it was.
So just so you're aware, there was no major changes. As Annie was reviewing, I think there was an employee that, a position that needed to be updated.
Yeah. I just wanted them to have the updated copy for this.
No, I appreciate that. Yeah, absolutely.
I'm sorry, Annie. Please continue. You're welcome.
Did you get a copy?
Oh, you left.
Okay, Annie. Sorry. Thank you, Ms. Coleman.
Oh, no, you're fine. Thank you. So as Dr. Sue had shared, so this Crowe-Horwath study was approved and undertaken in, I believe, summer of 2014. And so part of that classification study was a recommendation of four employee groups: management, professional, technical, and support. And so here we are, finally placing the miscellaneous employees within sort of a family group of employees. And so it was a two-part process, really. We looked at job descriptions, current job descriptions, which you will see on Attachment A under the column of job title. And so we first had to look at the job description and then look at the definition for the recommended employee categories, which is in the board report for professional, technical, and support. So we aligned those job titles to a new classification based on that definition from Crowe-Horwath for a professional employee, for a technical employee, and for support. Then the next step was, what is going to be the health insurance premium contribution rate? We cannot arbitrarily assign a rate. Currently, we have board-approved rates of 6, 10, and 12%. So the rates that we assigned have to be the board-approved rates. So then we looked at the job descriptions, and we had to align them with the current employee group and the contribution rate. So, for example, if you have a job description that aligned with, it's a clerical function, it aligns with the secretary, then their rate would be, recommended rate would be a 10% rate. And if their job description aligned with a facilities employee, a service employee, then the recommended rate would be 12%. So that is how we came up with the recommended rates for these newly reclassified miscellaneous employees.
I'd like to thank you, Dr. Sue and Annie, for your work on this. And my understanding is that miscellaneous will be eventually moved, but you want to give them some time based. I just wanted to thank you for pointing that out, because that's where the confusion lay with me. So I know when we met on our one-on-one, you explained that very clearly, and I get it. And so that'll be moving into the following year so that everybody has time. Is that
That is correct. Correct. And thank you for pointing that out. Yes, this recommendation is for July 1st of 2017. So people have, you know, advance notice and time to transition and prepare.
I have a question. So I'm looking at let's just go to the TSTs as an example.
Correct.
And I do appreciate us giving, thank you for doing this, and I'm glad that we're able to give this opportunity the time frame so that people can prepare, so this is great. The TSTs, they were under miscellaneous before, from what I understand, they're moving to technical, and this really could probably fall into any category, but I'll pull the largest group out. 25 mm-hmm. employees were in that group. So they fell under miscellaneous, which means that their benefits were considered miscellaneous. So for instance, a TST who is miscellaneous may have not gotten off on a certain, they may have, like, for vacation days, like 404, during spring break, let's say they had to work because they were in a miscellaneous category. When they move to their new classification assignments, and I'm just pulling TST because they're the largest group, will they then move to the new classification benefit structure? So like if computer specialists weren't allowed to, they had to come in and work during spring break because they were in miscellaneous category, but now they're moving to technical, and technical staff used to be able to get off during spring break. And I'm using spring break. It could be Christmas break. It could be whatever. Will they now move into that specific classification assignment based on their, am I babbling? Does that make sense? Am I babbling?
No.
Oh, because everyone's looking at me like they don't know what I'm talking about. But what policy do they fall under?
Sure.
I know, because I'm like, everyone's looking at me like they. Do y'all get it? Okay. Then I'll stop talking.
So they would. So they would fall under the AST policy. So they would be under technical.
So wherever they move to, it will move. They will move to that,
yes,
whatever that group has, right?
Yes.
So if I'm miscellaneous, and I'm a program director, and I'm under miscellaneous, and under my miscellaneous, it used to be where I would have to work during spring break, but support staff didn't. So now that I'm moving to a support staff role or category classification, I would then now be whatever that classification is.
Correct.
Well, right.
Okay. Does that make sense? Okay.
But right. Just to clarify, this technical category is defined by Crowe Horwath, and it's different than what the technical is by definition for the AST policy. So right now, for example, we have some facilities managers and specialists that are labeled technical, but they would not fall per se under that policy. They would use the employee handbook, if that makes sense.
Basically, you right now, if you remember the miscellaneous policy, we let it expire.
That expired.
So
right.
HR had to assign them to a current existing policy, because we can't make up a policy without board approval either. So we only had really technically two policies left: the handbook, those conditions in the handbook, and or an AST policy that drives it. And we will be in the next year or so coming forward, because that is an area that really has to be addressed, the benefit policy overall for the district. So another big topic to work with you and develop as we move forward. So right now, though, that's what exists. So we couldn't, again, arbitrarily make up a new policy for people. You just can't do that. So we had to sign them based on where they fit by that job classification and their duties and responsibilities between just two policies that currently exist, if that helps.
Then the answer really wasn't yes.
Yes. They would go under the AST policy.
Right. So the answer really isn't yes, that they move into that technical category. They really move into the category under technical, but then under technical there's layers.
So the technical definition for crow horwath defines and provides examples, right? It says involves integration of information technology. It also includes operation and maintenance of buildings. It gives examples of what are all types of jobs that can fall under a technical category. But the technicals defined for purposes of AST, that policy is different. So, right. So,
okay.
Does understood. That make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I turned it off. Actually, I'm trying to extend it. I don't know who's first. Was it Dan?
Mr. Wade?
First of all, I haven't got any questions. I just want to thank you very from the bottom of my heart, because when I first noticed that we had miscellaneous employees, that's almost like watching a Clint Eastwood movie, Pale Rider, A Man with No Name. You know, it shouldn't have happened, and I hope it doesn't in the future, because it, and again, all the hard work, and I realize the headaches. Apologize for that, but great job.
Thank you.
I like your analogy there. I was one of those pale riders when I worked for the district, so I think it's really important too. And I do understand that with the changes, when they're reassigned to the categories that actually fit, because I know we had some glitches in that study itself, that will come forward along with the changes as well as the insurance. So they'll all fit into the correct categories, even if we have to rework that. Okay, right? Okay, thank you for your hard work on this. I know it's been a long, drawn out process, but I appreciate the hard work.
I think my questions are beyond what we're talking about here tonight, so we'll go ahead and... Any other questions on this piece? Mrs. Mayor Schneider.
I'll make the motion then to accept administration's recommendation. Including, I'm sorry, Gary was supposed to do that.
That's okay.
I got in a hurry.
I defer.
All right. To approve the newly assigned contribution rates noted in the revised attachment A for reclassified miscellaneous employees.
And I'll second that motion.
Okay.
It's been properly moved and second. Any further discussion?
I didn't know if you had that.
We have a motion on the floor. All in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it. Motion carries. At this time, we'll move to the renewal of superintendent employee contract. Superintendent of school, Dr. Sue Savaglio Jarvis, was appointed to her position effective July 21st, 2014. Her current contract expired on June 30th, 2016. I'll entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion to accept the board's recommendation on renewing Dr. Sue Jarvis. Savaglio Jarvis. I am really off on this. I apologize.
Dr. Sue.
I'm trying to be formal. It's right there. Dr. Savaglio Jarvis. Jeez. And I'm not dragging it out. And I want to say thank you for your hard work on the district.
Mrs. Stevens, can
yes.
I ask that you read the entire recommendation
yes.
that's printed? Because it has that extra piece in there. So I'm going to ask before we...
Thank you.
Okay.
Before we second it?
Yes, please.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks for pointing that out to me. Okay, so it is recommended that the board approve the renewal of superintendent's employment contract for the period of July 1st, 2016 through June 30th, 2018, with the option of a one-year extension through June 30th, 2019. Good?
Do we have a second?
All right.
It's been properly moved and second. Any discussion? I'd just like to say I have been on this board for 4.5 years, and I've sat under 3 superintendents while on this board, and I am honored to serve alongside Dr. Sue Savaglio Jarvis. She is honest. She is fair. She communicates effectively with this board, and she works extremely hard. I only have one directive for Dr. Sue. Actually, I have 2 directives, and I think the board will agree with me. She must take vacation days.
Mr. Smogdale?
That's the first one.
Make her do that.
And the second one is we have to find a way to add something into her contract, board, that she is not emailing after a certain time in the evening and in the morning.
Yeah.
Right, right. I mean, I go to bed and read an email. I wake up and there's an email. I start to really wonder, does she sleep? And then I did talk to her husband, and he confirmed that she does sleep, everyone. I will tell you, he has confirmed. But in all seriousness, she works extremely hard for this district, and you are highly respected in not only Kenosha and our district, but nationally and statewide. And now I know nationally people are definitely noticing KUSD because of Dr. Sue Savaglio-Jarvis. I know today you were out of the district and representing us at CISA 1, just always on the go. But I do mean that about those emails and that sleep. But thank you, Dr. Sue, for just being a wonderful person, being true to who you are, and just being a wonderful individual. And I really it's a pleasure working with you. Lights are all over the place up here. I know I made you guys want to speak, huh? Mr. Fikulski?
Dr. Sue, I just wanted to thank you for your hard work and your high-level professionalism. And really, I've been impressed with the way you rebuilt trust. I think, you know, when you came, trust was at an all-time low in this district, at least from the time I've been around this district. So it's really been great to see all that hard work and to see that pay off, and that the staff and the community has responded well to that. And just thank you for, you know, always having solid advice and giving us good information so that we can make good decisions. Thank you.
Mr. Kunich?
Just echoing what Mike said and what Tamara said, I think, you know, when people look at this contract, they're going to see some changes in there. And I just want to reiterate that, yeah, I am trying, because 8:15 was mine. So
8:10.
So, no, honestly, I mean, there are some changes in there, and they're well-earned and well-deserved, you know, going into this. I mean, you've proven yourself. And we appreciate it. I think to put up with seven diverse personalities here and seven different opinions and, you know, people venting and whatnot, not easy. And so I appreciate it. And I just want the community to know it's a tremendous job that you do. And we're going to tell your dad on you if you email. So, all right.
You see how I threw that in there so her dad could hear
Wait
us.
Wait a minute. The real issue is I take after him. So that's a
oh,
problem.
Oh, no.
He started it all.
Oh, gosh. That's where it all came from. Mr. Garcia.
Dr. Sue, I just want to say congratulations. You deserve this contract. I just want to say, since I came aboard and you have echoed through the community before I even was elected to school board, you came up with an open-minded with the Hispanic community, which that's very important to me and also the community. And I found out that you've been communicating with the board and communicating with the community and communicating with the staff. You have such a wonderful staff that a great leader comes from a great staff that you have. And you have echoed through the community. And I want to thank you for everything that you have done for the community.
Well, I started thanking you, and then I realized I better read the motion completely. Thank you for reminding me, so we can make it extremely official. But I just want to thank you. It's been a pleasure working with you. Your energy level is spot on for this job. I mean, you got to have a lot of energy to do this job, and I've seen several superintendents over the years, as you know, from serving, going into my 10th year on the school board. So, and your level of communication, I don't mind those because I know how it is. Sometimes you just wake up and you go, I got to send that out. But I can see where your staff might get a little tired trying to keep up with you.
No, Rebecca.
Just kidding. Like, no, thank you for your hard work and your dedication to our district and our community as well. Appreciate it and look forward to working with you moving forward.
Mrs. Stevens, 3 a.m. is never acceptable. I know. Mr. Wade.
Where does one begin? I can't top what everybody else said, but just on a personal note, in my 35 years of my other career, I've had the experience of working with administrators, chiefs, if you will, and you are by far and away the best organized leader that I have ever run across, and I mean that from the bottom of my heart. And also, I want to thank you personally for putting up with Tarek's and my sense of humor on occasions. It is really...
yours is out there.
Well, thank you.
I have until 8:10, so Mary, take your time.
No, I have to add my thanks as well. And I think one of the strengths I want to add to what other people have said, besides putting up with the 7 different personalities that you have to work with and changing. I mean, the board is changing. We know that. But you show a great level of respect for each one of us. And I've worked with you for many years in different roles. But as a superintendent, you show a great deal of respect for anybody who comes to you with an idea. You do the research and information, so decisions are based on data. You try to present everything to us, and I greatly appreciate the work and the effort that you do and the kind of respect you show to board members and our community and our students, because all of us are interested in that. That's what the goal is, and you keep us focused on that goal. So thank you.
I'll just say I'm truly humbled.
We have a motion on the floor, Dr.
Oh, you do? I can't. Okay.
You have to wait to after the motion.
We have a motion on the floor.
Then you can speak.
All in favor, please state by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it. Motion carries. Thank you, Dr. Sue Savaglio Jarvis.
Thank you. Please go around and shake everybody's hand.
Give you all hugs. It's truly humbling. And people ask me, how do you do what you do? And I just say, because it's the people, the boots on the ground, as they say. This job is truly about the people in the schools, in my leadership capacity. It's their dedication and determination that keeps me running as fast as I can. So maybe they need to slow down so I can slow down. Let's shift it. They're like, all right. But I truly appreciate your thoughts and very humbled. And again, I've never, any job that I've done, it's because of the students and the staff in this amazing, amazing district. That's what keeps me running. And I want nothing but the best for our staff. And it's that emotional piece that you just, because you care so much about the quality of who we work with. We are truly, truly blessed to have amazing community, amazing staff, amazing students. And boy, that makes the job easier. And that's why I continue to do what I do. It's really not about me. It's about my service to our community and service to my team, because they work just as hard trying to probably keep up with me. But it's their commitment. And you guys hit the nail on the head earlier. Without a fantastic team, this would be really tough. This leadership team is dedicated, extraordinary, top level. And we should be, again, very honored to include them in this recommendation for all of us moving forward together. So thank you to everybody, and thank you. Very humbled.
Thank you, Dr. Savaglio Jarvis. I told her she needed to get up like we do with the awards and walk around and shake everybody's. We should do the official. We should stand up. That's what we do. I am. Leadership, you'll get an email of thanks at about 3 a.m. You know how it goes. Well, this concludes our...
Are you sure there's no other...
Motion to adjourn.
No other business.
Oh.
Okay.
No, I object.
I know. So we have been betting about how long our meetings take, and so we all have times here. So that's why we're all trying to, the ones that are after 8 o'clock are kind of holding on, but we do have a motion on the floor to adjourn, and we are now adjourned. Thank you.